Welcome, everyone.
Everyone who longs for truth, needing hope and strength renewed, come and meet the Savior of the world. Everyone who longs inside, desperate for the words of life, come and meet the Savior of your soul. God is with His love rains down, His love rains now. Saved by grace and power, His love rains down, His love rains now. God is with us now.
Hallelujah!
Everyone who lives in Christ, died to self and raised to life, come and praise the Savior of the world. Everyone who perseveres, faithful overcome all fears, come and praise the Savior of your soul. God is with us. His love rains down, His love rains down. Saved by grace and power, His love rains down, His love rains down. God is with us now. Nothing can ever separate us. God is with us now. Nothing can take His promise from us. God is with us now. Nothing can take the place of Jesus. God is with us now. No more shame, no more fear. We are free, 'cause God is here. Is with us now. His love rains down. His love rains down. Saved by grace and power. His love rains down. His love rains down. God is with us. His love rains down, His love rains down. Saved by grace and power, His love rains down, His love rains down. God is with us now.
Come on, lift your voice and shout, somebody. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah.
You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. fear is crippling. You are true, you are truth, ever in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign.
You are more.
You are more. You are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord. You are Lord. All creation will proclaim. You are here. You are here. Your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever raised. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reigns. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus.
Come on and cry out to him.
My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus.
And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love
nothing compares to your embrace, light of the world forever.
Come on, one more time.
I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace, light of the world forever.
Before we go further into worship, we're going to have a few announcements. You want to go ahead and take your seats. Let's welcome Cindy.
First, just a huge thank you to all the servants in the house. With that being said, we do need some extra help on Tuesday mornings cleaning. We need people to come and vacuum, sweep and mop, clean the kitchen, the restrooms. We just had a few people here today, and it got done, praise God, but we could really use the help. So if you're available to come on Tuesday mornings, we get here at 10 o'clock to clean, so please. The other thing, when you invite people to church, and keep in mind I said when, not if, when you're inviting people to church and you're telling them that we have transportation, let them know that there are specific call-in times. A lot of you don't know that, but in order for them to get a ride to church on a Tuesday and a Saturday night, they need to call by 3 o'clock. And on for a ride on Sunday, they need to call Saturday night by 5 o'clock. So please just let them know that. And if you forget what I'm saying, feel free to call the church and press option 1 and listen to the recorded message, and all that information is there.
Also, men, we're also getting ready for our men's breakfast. Typically, we have it on the first Saturday of the month, but because it's Labor Day weekend, we are moving it to the next Saturday, so it'll be the 8th instead of the 1st. I do encourage you all to come out. We do have a guest speaker that's going to be blessing us with that word that morning. Breakfast is free. We start at 8 o'clock, so I hope to see all you men there.
So let's all stand again. I want you to greet your neighbors right now, to your right, to your left, and just welcome them tonight.
You reign victorious. the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb, seated on the throne. Crown you now with many crowns. You reign. I am lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb, seated on the throne. Crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious. I am lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. 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 Hallelujah. You're worthy, God. You're worthy. Bless your name. How we draw close to you, God. We draw nigh to you, you would draw nigh to us, God. Ooh, have your way.
Will do, 'cause nothing else can.
and Lord, never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend.
You are my desire.
You are my desire.
No one else.
And no one else will do.
Nothing else can take your place.
Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way.
It brings me back. We draw close to you tonight. Come on, every voice.
You're
tonight that all you need is his presence. Moses said, if you will not go with us, then count me out, I'm not going. Jesus still saves, delivers, and heals. No matter what the problem is that we're facing tonight, he's bigger. Can I have an amen? He's bigger than addiction. Have I got a witness? They say there's no cure for the AIDS virus. I say there is. His name is Jesus. Pastor Gus had asked me a couple of weeks ago to come and actually a couple years ago to come and when I would come to share some of the LTC leadership training class stuff that we had from our church. And so I was all set to preach on the Absalom spirit, to teach on it. And this morning I had a dream. And that's one of the major ways God communicates with me. Well, this is the first major way. Amen. The Nike commercial, just do it. But I had a dream, and in the dream that I had this morning, and one of the ways you know it's God, well, first of all, you usually just know, but you'll wake up out of it. Read Genesis, where Pharaoh dreamt. He woke up out of it when it's from the Lord. And anyhow, in the dream, I was just ministering, and it didn't look exactly like this. I'm not sure where it was, and a couple of the details don't always make sense, you know. How many of you want God to send the blueprint down with the how he's going to do it, when he's going to, and it's all got to make sense. But in the dream, there was a powerful anointing, just heavy. And I remember screaming under in that presence. I said, anybody can be healed of anything. The anointing is here. And then the climactic part, and see, I'm trying to tell you this dream. It's impossible to tell it when you were there and felt it. But I have an aunt. My uncle's already gone to heaven, and they're hardcore Baptists. God bless the Baptists. God loves Baptists. And very much in, you know, eternal security and predestination. And my uncle would always say, he's, like I said, he's already passed, but he would always say, if you didn't get eternal life, he said, I'm not talking about this start-stop thing. He said, if you didn't get eternal life, he said, you didn't get it. So he was real hardcore with it. But anyhow, so they're very, very Baptist. And like, if you begin to like talk about healing and stuff, they kind of hit the brakes on you. In my dream, my aunt came up and stood before me, and God touched her. Now watch, this is funny, because in the dream she fell down, and the floor was a little dusty because she got up kind of dirty, and she jumped up real quick like that didn't happen. For everybody that was watching, that didn't really happen. And then God touched her again. I mean, this time, I don't know, sometimes you don't have words. Like, God ran her over with a Mack truck with the presence of the Lord. And she fell down again, but this time she couldn't get up. And I think the significance, and then she began to laugh. I mean, laugh her head off. Touch somebody and tell them you need to laugh your head off. Gets in the way. And I believe the significance of that part of the dream was that God may demonstrate some things tonight for those who struggle to believe. And so I called Pastor Gus and I told him, I said, I don't think I'm preaching what I told you I was going to preach. He said, you know what he said. He said, you just obey the Lord. I knew that's what he would say, but I still wanted to be appropriate. Call him. You're all I need. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want.
Every hand in this place and worship the Lord tonight.
You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near.
Let's sing that verse.
Draw me close to you.
Make it a prayer.
And never let me go.
Surrender it right now.
I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend.
You are my desire.
You are my desire. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a way, bring me back to
I believe that before I got filled with the Holy Spirit, that subconsciously, not aware of what I was doing, when I smoked marijuana, when I tried LSD, when I became addicted to cocaine, I didn't realize that there was something inside of me that wanted God. And I was trying to find it. I really was. On the conscious level, I was just trying to have fun. But there was, I longed. And because when I got filled with the Holy Spirit, I remember that was one of the first thoughts that went through my head. I've been searching for this my whole life. I want to say this too. I want to just share this. My pastor, Pastor Willie, he's must be about the same age as Pastor Punnels. And his wife got saved first. Let me just tell you their testimony just real quick. They made more money on Friday night and Saturday night playing secular music in a bar. In two nights, they made more money than he made all week working at the lumber mill. And then his wife went and messed everything up. She went and got saved. We're laughing, but he was an alcoholic, and he was mean, and he had a reputation for fighting. Great big man. He's 6'5". And Pastor Georgia, listen to me. You got to hear what I'm saying right here, and I'll tell you how he got filled with the Holy Ghost. She took a stand. I heard Catherine Kuhlman say sometimes women have more courage than four men. She took a stand. She said, I don't go there anymore. I don't play that music anymore. And he said, fine, you take all three little girls. And back in that day, they didn't have children's church. And she was trying to get her soul fed with three little babies right there on the row. And she got saved first. He was angry and got drunk. And the old word is threw a drunk. And he called her pastor. About a week later, he'd been drunk that long. And the pastor was scared to meet with him. The pastor knew his reputation, thought he might beat him up. But he gave his heart to the Lord. But listen to me here. Just listen to this part. If she wouldn't have taken a stand, neither one of them would be saved tonight. So just as she got saved first, she also got filled with the Holy Spirit first. And he's just, he wasn't raised in church. He was raised just in a home with, and then was an alcoholic. And she was, came up on the platform and got prayer. And the Spirit of God touched her, and she fell back and hit her head on the piano bench. Pow! He said he heard it in the back. And he ran to the front to check on his wife, figured she'd be bleeding, you know, messed up. And he runs up there and leans over, and she's speaking in tongues. And her head's okay. And it freaked him out, and he ran. Pew! Out the church. Ran out of the church. But he knew something happened. He knew it was real. So he came back to church. Next service, I guess. And he began to seek and desire to be filled with the Holy Spirit too. But watch how he got filled. This is cool. It was a Sunday evening service. And a man came in the back. A drunk man. He'd been drunk. How many of you understand what I'm saying if I said for years? And he smelled like urine. And he kind of disrupted the service just a little bit. And so Pastor Willie's pastor said, can you love this man? He said, I got it, Pastor. And he went back in the back. And he held that man. And he loved that soul. And in that moment, he was filled with the Holy Ghost. We don't use the Holy Spirit like we tried to use drugs. But if we'll yield, He'll use us. If we'll offer an empty and yielded vessel, He'll fill you and He'll use you. Maybe tonight you're saying, you know, I've been trying to walk with the Lord and I'm still struggling. Well, first of all, you're very normal. Everybody say amen. But there's the same power that Jesus trusted, the same person. The word comforter also means strengthener. He wants to invade your life. He wants every decision to go through Him. Many people don't sell out to God because they don't trust Him enough. It's not just the right thing to do. God has the best. Don't surrender to Him just because it's the right thing to do and you know you've been doing wrong. Surrender to Him because you really believe He has the plan. He has the purpose. He holds your destiny. It's in Him. And sell out. And empty out. Pastor Gus came over Friday and he was preaching to me. I said, just keep preaching. He said, part of the problem is we just way too alive. We're supposed to be dead in Christ. Amen. Yes, Lord, I hear you. Right now. Fresh surrender. Sell out. Maybe there's some things you've been holding back. How honest can you handle it? When Pastor Gus, we hadn't hung out for a while. He came over Friday and we were over at our church. And so I said, I need you to pray for me. So there's an area where I got my heart hurt and I have not been right with God. And he prayed for me. It was a breakthrough moment. To God be the glory. But now's your moment. Who will sell out? Who will lay it all down? Come to the front. Just come stand in the front. Sell out. Fire sale. It's all going. It's all got to belong to Jesus right now. Come if you'll come. We can fit two or three deep up here and we'll fit you in the aisle. If God told you to come, obey Him. If you were supposed to come, then get up and get in the aisle. Obey the Lord. Obey the Lord. You'll be glad you did. He's got the best. You can trust Him.
Help me know You are near.
I'll pray for you in a minute, but there's still opportunity to obey Him. Make sure everybody in this place, everybody, mind the Lord. Mind the Lord. Just obey Him.
You're all
every voice.
I've ever needed.
Tell Him.
You're all I want. Help me know You are near. Draw me close to You.
Never let me go.
Never let me go.
This is our prayer. Sing it to the Lord. Sing this prayer. I lay it all down.
Lay it all down again.
To hear You say that You're my friend.
To hear You say that I'm Your friend.
You are my desire, Jesus.
You are my desire. No one else will do.
No one else can take Your place.
There's nothing else can take Your place.
To feel the warmth.
To feel the warmth of Your embrace.
Help me find the way. quickly, everybody up here in the front. Everybody up here in the front, I want to ask you to close your eyes, please. And just be real with God. Where you've been lagging back or holding back or have fallen back, whatever the case is, confess it to Him as sin. He has the answer for our sin. He's not intimidated, as Pastor Gus says, with my sin. And He promised us, He says, if you draw near to me, then I'll draw near to you. And so right now, draw close. Draw near. As He's drawing near to us. Don't stay focused on the sin now. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. Blessed is the man whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. 2 Corinthians 5:19 says He's not imputing our sins. He already made up His mind. Before you ever came to this altar, He already had His mind made up that what Jesus did at the cross was more than enough. More than enough. I want to encourage everyone to begin to seek, even in this service, another work of grace, even beyond being born again, the baptism in the Holy Ghost, the infilling of the Almighty Holy Spirit. Those of you up here in the front, you came up to press in, whisper a little prayer. If you've been filled with the Holy Spirit before, say, ask, baptize me again, Lord. If you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, if you're not sure what I'm talking about, then you haven't yet. And that's not a criticism. It's for you. There were no miracles, even in the ministry of the Son of the Living God, until He was filled with the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said that in His name we would do the very same things. In order to do that, we have to have the very same power source. Say this out loud. Precious Jesus, my Savior, You are my baptizer. I need to be baptized according to Your word in Your Holy Spirit. I yield everything. I empty out, that You might fill me full. Be real with Him right now. Be real with Him right now. Is anybody here that would just say, Jesus, I need to be more like You? When we're trying to compare ourselves to each other, that's not the comparison. We must compare ourselves to Jesus. And I have so much room to grow. I have such need of You, Lord. Up here in the front, lift your hands in a position of expectancy. Just in the natural, you're doing something to receive in the spiritual. Two things with your hands lifted up. One is like a two-year-old saying to that parent, Daddy, pick me up and hold me in your arms. But also with your hands lifted up in a receptive position,
that is God breaks forth from heaven upon us now, that you receive. Are you okay if I teach just like this? Just like this for a few minutes? Are everybody okay? I want to encourage everybody up here in the front. Just stay right there. Just stay right there. Just stay right there. Let me teach just for a minute. And in your seats, if you want to sit down, you're welcome to. Just let me teach just right here, right? Just like this. Just like this. I'm just going to give you some scriptures. Watch this. Pay attention. You're in school. The first time other than directly under Jesus the people are filled with and baptized in the Holy Ghost is Acts 2. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord. That means they were one heart in one place, kind of like us right here in this room. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. They literally heard something with their natural ears. And it filled the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues. Imagine this. Just imagine this. Just picture this with me. If these people up here, suddenly we begin to see flames on their heads. There wouldn't be any unbelievers. Like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, gave them utterance or ability. You can't teach people to speak in tongues. Hang on, I'm gonna teach. Okay, then. Now, quiz question. How did they know as they looked at other people, the fire on their head, that'd be a clue. I think they got something. And it didn't even burn their hairspray. But what? Listen. There are 9 gifts or manifestations. Say manifestation. The word manifestation means it becomes aware to our 5 natural senses. Something happens so that you know, even with your stupid natural brain, that's God. In this case, when they were filled with the Holy Ghost, the manifestation, I like it like that, because sometimes we say gifts, and that's, I don't know, it became known to the senses. What was it? Tongues. Now, right there, some people are clamming up, it was a good teaching, here we go. It's the Bible. They got filled with the Holy Ghost, and the evidence of that baptism was tongues. If you don't like tongues, thank you. Get over it. I'm reading from the Holy Bible. Okay, watch. And then I'm just hold on. Then Acts chapter 8, and we see a deacon. This guy, all he did before was he served breakfast on Sunday morning. Then a persecution hit, and people were spread all over the place. And he goes from deacon to evangelist. Some of you are already evangelists, you know, and Jesus said the greatest would be the servant. So don't worry about titles and stuff. Just keep bringing them to church. Just keep winning them for Jesus. And this Philip guy goes, and watch this. This guy was so crazy for God, so filled with the Holy Spirit, he gets a whole city saved, Samaria. And this city wasn't just ripe for the picking. It had witchcraft and all kinds of crazy stuff. Then Philip goes down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Say manifestation. They were something was happening. Something was happening. But even in all of that, the believers, the new believers in Samaria, weren't filled with the Holy Spirit until the apostles came. And when they, the apostles, were come down, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he, the Holy Spirit, had not fallen on any of them. They were only baptized in water in the name of Jesus. And when the apostles laid their hands on them, they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon, this guy's into witchcraft, saw that through the laying on of hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money. Now just hold up. It doesn't say this time that it was tongues. It doesn't say they were falling over and flapping around. It doesn't say. But something happened. Because even this guy that's into witchcraft, he said, whoa. When they lay hands on them, they're getting filled with the Holy Ghost. Because he saw something. Now watch this. Watch this. Acts chapter 10, verse 46. I'll start with 44. Let me just back this up just real quick. God loves Italians. This is awesome because this is some of the, these are the first Gentiles to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Everybody in Acts 2 was Jewish. Say amen. I shouldn't say first because Samaria, sorry. But check this out. So Cornelius sees an angel. The angel says, send for Peter. Peter is one of the 12 apostles. And he's packing. Silver and gold have I none, he said. But what I have, here you go. The guy got more than a couple quarters. 44, while Peter is still preaching, the Holy Ghost falls on Cornelius' house, all of his family and friends. And they of the circumcision, that means the Jewish guys that were already believers, they were astonished. How are these Gentiles? What is going on? This is messed up. I've never seen this before. Because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Manifestation, say it. Something happened. One of the nine gifts manifested. One of the nine manifestations. Miracles, healing, faith, tongues, interpretation of tongues, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, one, prophecy. One of the nine gifts. Let me show you one more thing. I'm teaching. Acts 19. Watch this. I was raised in a denominational church. They said they believed the whole book. I never felt God in that church like you're feeling right now. And I don't mean that in criticism. Okay, watch. But one day, check it out. It doesn't matter what church you're in, you can read. We had just started Gateway Bible Church. I wasn't married to Tammy yet. And there, one of the buildings on our campus was like a bachelor pad full of young Christian guys. I was in Bible college at the time and had already been ordained to pastor that church. And reading what I'm about to read to you, I got filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, in church that I grew up in, I can remember sometimes feeling the presence of the Lord a little bit. And I remember sometimes with a song, I got goosebumps. That was it. But what happened to me on this day, this is Acts 19, beginning with verse 2. Paul meets these guys, and he said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Isn't that interesting? The first thing he asked these new believers, have you been baptized in the Holy Ghost? That was his first question. And they said unto him, we haven't even heard of the Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, then what were you baptized? And they said, John's baptism. And he explained to them that John baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying that they should believe on him that would come after him. That was on Christ Jesus. Listen, when they heard this, They were baptized in water in the name of the Lord. Everybody say they were obedient. But watch this next part. And Paul is the 12th apostle of that time. When Paul laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. Four witnesses that when you get filled with the Holy Spirit, something amazing. There will be manifestation, one of the nine gifts. Typically, usually, since Pentecost hit America in 1906 in the Azusa Street Revival, that was the first time in the United States there was a great sweeping move of the Holy Spirit of God, and many, many people were baptized in the Holy Ghost, evidenced tongues, not necessarily for the sake of another language, although God can do it. He did it in Acts chapter 2. Tongues not necessarily to be interpreted as prophecy, but as an evidence. A manifest, something happened. Now everybody up here, are you willing to look foolish? How many of you found out you don't tell God what you're not going to do? Ask Jonah. Well, I'm all in except that tongue thing. You'll be talking in tongues loud. Everybody be looking at you. You'll be saying in your brain, I want to stop. And the Holy Ghost said, I got you. How many of you would admit God needs to get a hold of your tongue? That thing needs to be sanctified. How many of you believe that one of the biggest differences between Christians and unbelievers should be the way we talk and our tongue? Tongues is bizarre. All of the manifestations are supernatural. We seem like we like prophecy, and we like the healing. We like the miraculous. If you're gonna go into the supernatural realm, it's supernatural. And it opens up on both sides. Angelic, demonic. You really open the door once Jesus was filled with the Holy Ghost in the waters of baptism by his second cousin, John the Baptizer. From that day forward, everywhere he went, there was demonic manifestation. People, their eyes were rolling back. And demons are speaking up out of him. And he said, shush. You be quiet. They knew who he was. May there be no division in the body of Christ. May we come to the conclusion that the Word of God is the truth. And whether I comprehend it and completely understand it and am able to teach it accurately, if that's the Word of God, then I receive it. So let me tell you just real quick about when I got filled with the Holy Ghost. So it was a little bachelor pad, and my best friend, Mike Mueller, he's a pastor up in Washington now. And I said to Mike, I said, do you think this is still for today? You've got to understand my background was very, very conservative in a denomination. In fact, if you would have been talking like this in that denomination, they probably would have asked you to leave because they didn't believe that way, and it would have simply caused division. In fact, I did leave after I got filled with the Holy Spirit. We started. And so I said to Mike, do you believe that this still is for today? He said, I don't know. Why are you asking me? I said, because I think it is. He said, what are you basing that on? I said, the Bible. There's no verse that says it's not. Nowhere does it say this was just what those 12 apostles. No. No, God is still raising up the fivefold ministry today. There may be in this crowd right here apostles, prophets, pastors, evangelists, and teachers. And so he goes, well, we better pray about this. So we did, in sincerity. We're like, Lord, because I was like, I'm going to lay hands on you. And man, when you tell people that are in denominations, I'm going to lay hands on you, they'll run. Ah! And so we prayed about it. Our conclusion was that if it was in the Bible, it would not offend God. So I prayed for him. Nothing really happened. Then he prayed for me. And I asked God years later, why did it go like that? And he said, because you're the pastor. When he put his hands on me, heaven opened. Never before in my entire life had I ever felt God at this level. Something like wind, fire, and electricity came down through the roof and went through me, and yet remained in me. And I can't even remember, but apparently I fell down. Now listen to me. The church I grew up in had poisoned my mind on this very subject. The things I'm teaching you from the Bible right now, my mind had been poisoned. To say that that's tongues is bad. I don't know that they ever said that, but it's like, we just don't go there, okay? I hit the floor, and I'm screaming. I'm loud. I don't even need this thing. I can preach loud. And I'm screaming, it's real. It's real. And you may be thinking, oh, you're saying the baptism of the Holy Ghost is real. No. That's right. Here I'd been raised in church my whole life. And in that moment, it felt like 5 tons of doubt came off of me. And I knew that I knew that I knew that God had sent his son. And that he died on a cross and was raised on the third day. His spirit beareth witness with our spirit that we are the sons, the children of God. After that, I had to admit that some of the things that I had believed growing up in church just weren't quite lining up. You know, we don't want to hear that. It's work to really make adjustments in the very interior of us of what we really believe. And I began to open my heart and my mind, and I began to open my Bible. I tore the 14th chapter of 1 Corinthians apart, trying to understand speaking in tongues and praying in tongues, and when is it appropriate, is it okay in church? I wanted to know. I remember there's a couple spots I just noticed on Acts 2, it's messed up. But if you're hungry, you go, and I began, and 1 Corinthians 14, that's about the gifts in church. And I know, because I'm a pastor. I got to do this thing right. I want it right. And I began to find out that there was praying in tongues. What's that? Does God make anybody pray in English? No. Does God make anybody pray in tongues? No. And it's not speaking in tongues. It's prayer. Two subjects. Watch this. I'm going to blow your brain box here. There's more in the New Testament about tongues, speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues of men, tongues of angels, praying in tongues. There's more about tongues than there is water baptism. Don't believe a word I'm saying. You read your Bible. And so I began to try to unlock my brain from my training in religion. And one day I bought a book at the Christian bookstore by Watchman, Korea, North, thank you, Paul Youngi Cho. And I got in the truck and I sat down and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and he said, open the index. And I opened the index and there's a chapter on prayer language by the guy that's probably the pastor of possibly the largest church on the planet. He might know something, possibly. Sounds like he's a soul winner. And when I saw that, I said to the Lord, I'm sorry. And he said to me, you're stubborn. He said, you one stubborn kid. I said, I repent. Help me, Lord. I'll open my mind. I'll open my heart. From that moment forward, I began to try to pray in tongues. You have no idea how difficult this was. And listen to me, just hear my testimony, just hear me out. My mind gave me trouble. Your mind wants to rule. God says, I'm going to part the Red Sea. How? I want to know. I have to know. I have to analyze it. I have to understand it. I have to comprehend it. I want to know. When I would get in my prayer closet and I would try to pray from my spirit, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth. And my mind is unfruitful. What is it that I will pray with the spirit? I will sing with the spirit. And I would, and when I do that, my mind would go, hey, you can't do that. That's crazy. I finally had to say to my mind, you shut up and get submitted. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. And if we're carnally minded, it leads to death. But if we're spiritually minded, it leads to life. And so now watch this. Tell somebody, tell them God has a sense of humor. So now I'm in a board meeting. A board meeting. And the church, we didn't even have, this was like when it was at the house. We were in a bedroom to have the board meeting. My father, who'd been in the church I grew up in 40-something years, I'd been in it almost 25. And then my friend Greg, Mike was there. And we had, God forbid, a lady over elder. Anyway, I won't even go there. And the Holy Spirit, we had a great meeting. In fact, there had been a little offense between two of the overseers, and it got healed. And we're just about to close the meeting, and the Holy Spirit says to me, I want you to have them lay hands on you. The church I grew up in, you didn't lay hands on nobody. Lay hands on us, we get arrested. And I said, guess what I said, being the man of, why? What are you doing? That's what I asked the Lord. He said, just obey me. Okay, everybody, listen, I just really feel like, I told him in the board meeting, I feel like you're supposed to pray for me. And so I knelt down. My dad's in front of me. I'm the youngest of six. He's praying for his pastor, the brat of the family. And they're all gathered around. They laid their hands on me and they prayed for me. And dad's praying, and he's all this is happening like in a split second. I'm freezing time for you here. And the Holy Spirit said, now pray like I taught you to pray. I said, no. I mean, I said, N-O, no. Don't look all holy at me. You've told God no before. And the Holy Spirit went like this. I said, okay, let's make a deal. I will obey you, but I'm going to pray so that they can't hear me. I will. And he said, that's fine. He said, just loose your tongue. I said, loose your tongue. See, I'm like, I know that was God because I haven't even thought. That's crazy. Loose your tongue. I knew that was the Lord. It wasn't me thinking to myself. I think I'm having this conversation with the Lord. Now, I was talking to God. He said, that's fine. Just loose your tongue. I'm like, that's weird. So here I am kneeling down. Again, my dad's in front of me. He's still praying. And I begin to go very intentionally, so quiet. I didn't want to freak them out. I didn't want to get kicked out of the church either. That same fire fell again. Now watch. I'm just telling you what happened, okay? And you know what? Listen to me very carefully right here. Do not take my experiences over this. Go with this. I obeyed the Lord. The next thing that happened was that same fire fell again. Even greater intensity this time. Because watch what happens. I can't explain this to you. I don't know that I can even give you a verse. I'm just going to tell you what happened to me. So here I am like this, praying, right? And it's like, I go, whoop, 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 whoop. I'm watching. I'm watching this now. That doesn't make sense to me. And I get filled with the Spirit of God, and I stand on my feet, and I'm speaking in tongues at the top of my strength. And listen to me. Literally, I don't know how long. I don't know if it was 30 seconds or 120. God took over. He had a hold of me, and I wasn't driving. I was back there going, whoa, that's cool, I think. What's the board's reaction going to be? My dad goes flying back, and it falls down in this couch. And he goes, I'm numb. All over, the glory of God hit him. A couple of the overseers, just like in the book of Acts chapter 2, a couple of them are saying, what is going on? Our pastor just freaked out. And a couple of them are going, this is God. This is the baptism in the Holy Ghost. This is amazing. One by one, every one of those people that were in that circle also got the baptism. The most amazing one was my father. Because even after that, he'd been in that religious church so long. He'd been taught so long that that's just weird and we just don't go there and we just keep the service in order. Listen, I believe there should be order. His order. If you really look at the book of Acts chapter 2, it looks like holy pandemonium. It looks like it's just out of control. Maybe God wants control back. I tell you the truth. I believe that the day is coming that what I experienced in that moment, I truly believe that God is able to come upon us if we want it in such a way that later everybody's telling us what happened. So what happened next? You went screaming out the back and went to the hospital. Started praying for people and they were getting healed. The police came and kicked you out because you were just out of control. But 20 people got healed and one guy got raised from the dead. Is God able? Is the Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever? And the power that belonged to the church of the first century belongs to the church of Fire and Water International 2012. Did you know for the most part the church in Europe has died? In Europe, many of the places that were once on fire for God are bars. Because watch, it's not about gimmicks. Come next week and see the dancing poodles in church. Bring a friend. When they come, addicted to drugs, the anointing of God falls on the place. And they're instantly delivered from the power of the devil. They'll go tell their family. They'll go bring their friends. Say amen now. I'm going to pray for you to receive the baptism. Before I do, is there anybody else that wants to get up here? And I'm going to obey God because he said he's going to demonstrate his power. So I will obey him. We'll see what God does. Understand this. I don't think I'm something. That dream that I had this morning, I said, man, if I was God, I would have gave that to somebody else that's more obedient. The Holy Spirit is a gift just like your salvation. It's not earned. But tonight it can be received. And if you don't have the exact same experience that I had, don't worry. It's coming. Don't worry about it. We don't turn God off and on like a switch. We don't do God like drugs. I want to feel good, Lord. But if we'll be yielded, he'll use us. Up here in the front, close your eyes, please. Close your eyes. If you're hungry for that baptism, tell him. If you want to do great exploits for your God, just tell him right now. Just tell him. Maybe you want to say it like this. I must have that baptism. I must have it. I must, Lord. We have to preach this. I don't know how we'll make it to heaven without it. I mean that from my heart. I'm not trying to be critical. I'm not saying that because this church is filled with the Holy Ghost, it's better than another church. I'm not saying that. That's not where I'm trying to come from. Everybody up in the front, please lift your hands. Please lift your hands again. This is what the Apostle Paul said in Acts 19. He said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Receive, 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 receive. Receive that baptism in Jesus' name. I'm going to just pray for a couple people up here in obedience to God. feel like I'm supposed to pray for you. Is that okay? You come right up here. There we go. There we go. First Corinthians chapter 2, Paul said, I did not come with enticing words of men's wisdom, but it came in demonstration of the Spirit, so that your faith would not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. As I started to lay my hand on her, the Holy Ghost said, you told me you'd let me lead. So I'm not assuming that I'm just supposed to run up here and just put my hand on you. But I know God told me to call you up, so I'm obeying him. And if he tells me to, then I will. Fill her, God. When God uses somebody, it doesn't mean he's endorsing them. Jesus said, in my name, you'll cast out devils, you'll speak with new tongues, you'll take up serpents. If you drink any deadly thing, in whose name? In his name. When God moves, whose name is endorsed? Jesus. And he'll use you just as sure as he'll use me. I'm not any spectacular equipment, but I am saved by grace. Sir, can I pray for you?
Stand right here. Have you ever been filled with the Holy Ghost?
No.
Never. You want it?
Yes.
Stretch your hands.
Stretch forth your hands. Touch this man. God, what you did for me, do for him. And we'll be careful that the name of Jesus gets the glory. Touch. Touch your feet, because you're going to go for him.
Yes.
You're going to go for him. We're all called to be missionaries. We're all called to be evangelists. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
I want you to imagine just for a minute of all. I rearranged my sentence. You cannot imagine all that God has for you. You can't imagine it. You could try and you could say, yeah, that scenario where I go to the hospital. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Hi.
Touch. Thanks. 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 Gentlemen, pick him up. Help him up. What are you experiencing? What do you feel?
Lightheadedness. Like I'm drunk.
In Acts chapter 2, they accused them of being drunk. I pray that you get so filled with the Holy Ghost
that you get drunk in the Spirit.
How you doing? How you feeling?
Can't. No words can describe it.
Rejoice with him, somebody. I ask you to fill him up and mess him up. Agree with me. Fill him, Lord. Fill him, Lord. Fill him, Lord. Now what if this was just for him tonight? Are you still in? Are you still in? What if Before the foundations of the world, God ordained that this night would be his night. And that he would never be the same. Stretch your hands towards Tony.
Touch.
Favor. Like Mary, when Gabriel showed up, you found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Favor! Favor. What do you think? What do you think about this? That's the best part of that church. I'll tell you something. When you are in the anointing, when you're in the presence of God, don't move. Keep your eyes closed. Don't eat nothing. When you get in there, how many of you, you're all I want, you're all I ever needed. Anybody right now? I can tell when I preach who's drinking it in. This man's drinking it in. I started to pass you by. God said, hit the brakes. Put your hands on your belly, ma'am. I perceive in my spirit that you're receiving healing in your physical body. I don't know you. I don't know anything about you. But I declare that with Jesus' stripes, you are healed. And I decree by faith, this is your night for a miracle. I perceive relations being mended, and there's a financial need. Do you believe in miracles? Stretch forth your hands. Those of you sitting down, would you please stretch forth your hands? Just participate with me for a second. I dare you in Jesus' name to decree over her a financial miracle. A financial miracle coming from a source that you don't know, so that you'll know it's God. Hold this for a second, Dad.
Receive.
Bye-bye.
David's daughters, the virgins of the princesses, they had a special dress, a special robe. The Lord says unto you, this night I robe you. Be because you are my daughter. Stop seeing you through your eyes, saith the Lord, and begin to see you through mine. For you are my beloved daughter, and I robe you this night with the robe of a princess. I think we should give God praise.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Many times when Jesus got a hold of somebody's life, he changed their name, because with our name is our whole past. Your name. Don't. God says, my beloved daughter.
Would you help me for a second? Put your hands on the belly.
Church, you can't see me, but you can agree with me. The torment of the past goes. You are free. The Lord remembers it against you no longer. The blood of Jesus has washed it away. You are cleansed. You've been bought with a price. Everybody say this out loud. My beloved daughter.
My beloved.
The Lord says to you, my beloved daughter. Can we just take 30 seconds and worship Jesus? Thank you, Jesus.
Worshiper. Thank you for helping me pray for that lady. And I pray that God touches you.
Touch!
Magnificent presence. Let her never be the same. From this night forward, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name.
Anybody here love Jesus? Tell him out loud, I love you, Lord. I'm not ashamed of you. Let me do this. Thank you, sir. Let me do this. I want you to be honest. How many of you would say, the tempter's been working me, I need strength? Lift your hand. I need strengthened. If I'm going to ask you, if your hands are lifted, please stand just for a minute. You can sit back down in a minute. But if you need strength, just lift. This doesn't come from me. This, right in this moment, will not come through me. Because I need strengthened. But we petition the throne of God Almighty, according to Philippians 4 and 13. Strengthen us now to do your will. Strengthen us now to walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh.
Make an appointment right now. Eyes closed for a second. Make an appointment, a worship appointment. Or you go at home, and you go in your prayer closet, and you turn on some worship, or you just sing to the Lord, or you just pray. Make an appointment right now. Jesus went from prayer meeting to prayer meeting. And there were amazing miracles. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
There were amazing miracles in between. And when we miss those appointments, we should not be surprised. I should not be surprised that I'm weak against the tempter. Christian means like Christ. He dismisses the crowd and he goes up on the mountain to be alone with Abba. Say that word. He's your daddy. Say that word.
Abba.
Abba. Make that appointment. Make that appointment. Now help me. I'm going to close the service, I think. But I have to close it like this. If we're closing it. Or if not, this is a preliminary. To the name of Jesus alone be the glory for everything that's happened here tonight. To Jesus be the praise. We believe that more than we could see, more than we could sense, more than we could feel, more than we can know, that you've done great things, and great is your name, and greatly to be praised. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I bless in the name of Jesus, I bless Fire and Water International Church, Pastor Gus, Pastor Robert, Pastor Frank, Bessie, all those who serve in this house. Better is a one day. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than spend 1,000 elsewhere. God, pour your strength, pour your power, pour your anointing, God, out on this house, out on this work. As it goes out over the internet, over television, use it to bring many to the saving knowledge of Jesus. Strengthen and encourage and bless Pastor Gus. Agree with me. Pray for your pastor a minute. Let's spend 2 minutes and pray for Pastor Gus. Strengthen him. Encourage him. Bring him back with fresh vision. Fresh vision. Fresh anointing. Fresh oil. According to Psalms 92:10. Fresh oil. Fresh fire. In this house, the right people in the right places. They're your people. So we all surrender and say, you move us on the chessboard according to your will. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done in the earth as it is in heaven. Strengthen Pastor Gus. And the whole church said. One more thing before we go home. Please help me with this. The offering buckets are up here. We did not receive an offering. I've been around Pastor Gus a long time. This is what he says. Here it is. I'm just going to copy him. Everybody just obey the Lord. You know, he doesn't push, does he? Say amen. You know why? You know why? Because there's faith on this side of the offering plate. He believes God will take care of it. Give God a great big praise offering. A big one. Hallelujah. Hug 19 people and tell them, at least 19, tell them Jesus saves, delivers, and heals. Okay. Can I have your attention for one more second? There's a man by the name of Mike in Pittsburgh. He's a pastor in Pittsburgh. Agree with me in prayer. Just before you walk out, freeze. Father, in the name of Jesus, touch Mike in Pittsburgh. We agree together. Whatever two or three would agree upon us touching will be granted of our Father which is in heaven. So we agree together in Jesus' name for a miracle of healing. And the whole church said, amen. Thank you.